sanity. All right, good morning. Man, it's good to see you guys today. Good morning to the live stream audience. Thank you guys for listening and getting here at 11. We're back to our old schedule. Praise the Lord for that. Thank you guys for being flexible, and I certainly think this is what's best. So, again, it's good to be in the house of the Lord. I got to give a praise as we get going here today. The Just Desserts production that we had Friday night and Saturday night was such a success. Can we give a round of applause to everybody who was involved with that? I tell you, a lot of work, a lot of blood, sweat, and tears went into that. It took a lot of people, but man, was it an awesome blessing to be a part of. They did such a phenomenal job. The food was great. The production went off really well. So again, thank you to everybody who made that possible. It really was cool to see that and how the Lord moved. Just a few announcements for you today. We still have elder and deacon nominations going on. If you want to nominate someone, the slips are in the back, and you can place your nomination in the tithe box. And so we're looking forward to voting on that here in the coming weeks. Also, our youth are headed to Scaremare this Friday, and so if you're interested in riding with them up there, if you're a teenager who wants to go, make sure you let Jason and Melissa know, but that's going to be an awesome time. I know that event all the way up in Lynchburg, they do a great job with. It's a great time for teenagers, and so we're looking forward to that as well. And then finally, I know it seems like maybe it's further in the distance, but it's really not. It'll be here before you know it. Just ask my wife. She'll tell you. Christmas is around the corner, and Operation Christmas Child is something that we take part of here at the church. Just an awesome ministry. You fill a shoebox with different items, and we send it off, and it makes such an impact. If you want to take your own box and fill it up, you can certainly do that. I know it's a lot of fun for families. If you just want to have it filled, the church will fill it for $30. But again, the ministry is so impactful. We actually have a short video to show you a little bit of that here right now.
When those lids come off those boxes, you have never seen such pure joy.
This is amazing. As you can see, the children's faces, they are excited as they open up the gifts for the first time.
What makes the gifts more than just gifts is the message that comes with the gift.
This is the opportunity for a child to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ.
The mission of Operation Christmas Child never changes. Children are coming to Jesus, and children are taking the gospel to the ends of the earth.
Millions of children around the world are being impacted by these simple shoebox gifts. One box can touch not just the child, but the whole family. So we need to keep packing those boxes and pray for the children that God will use this in a very special way. So thank you for being a part of it. God bless you.
Amen. And again, the gifts are awesome, and they go a long way. It may seem like a small thing to you, but it's such a big thing to those children, but also the message that comes with it, right? Spreading the gospel, being the hands and feet of Jesus. This is just another way that we can do that. And so the goal for the church this year is 150 boxes. I think we can knock that out of the park if you guys get behind that. And so if you're interested in that, you can grab one of the boxes over here, but we're looking forward to see how God is going to use that ministry this year here at Lighthouse. But again, thank you for being with us today. I would love to open us up in prayer. And then I will pass it off to Jill and the praise team. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for bringing us here together today. Thank you for just moving in this place today like you already have, Lord. And we're expecting you to do it again here in this service. Lord, be with my brother, Pastor Jay, as he brings the message from your word. Lord, there's nothing that cuts like your word. The Bible is so powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. And we're so thankful for it, God. And I just pray that you move in this place today. Let your Holy Spirit speak and work. Show off today, God, in a powerful way. And Lord, we promise to give you all the praise and glory that you deserve. For it's in your holy name that we pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So glad that you are here with us this morning. Are you ready to worship today?
Yes.
Yes? So glad that we can be here all together under one roof and worship this morning. And I wanted to share with you a verse from Psalm 150 before we get started this morning. Psalm 150, it says, "Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty firmament. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the lute and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and flutes. Praise him with loud cymbals. Praise him with clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And I love what the psalmist says, repeating and telling us to praise the Lord. We can sing and we can shout hallelujah for who he is. And if you have breath this morning, and I know you do because you're sitting in your seats and you're here. If you have breath in you this morning, that is a charge to us to sing praises to the Lord. Would you stand and worship with us this morning?
There's a melody. I've got a friend closer than a brother. There is no judgment. Oh, how he loves me. I've got a friend, and he is my strength. He is my portion. With me in the valley, with me in the fire, with me in the storm. Let all my life testify.
Hallelujah. We are not alone. God really loves us. God really loves us. Hallelujah. Oh, praise my soul. God really loves us. God really loves us. His mercy is enough.
Sweet love of Jesus Christ. It's a love that contains so much power and fullness. It's a love that seems incomprehensible and immeasurable to our human mind. But I praise the Lord that we can ask Him to give us the understanding. And I love what the Apostle Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 3. Paul is praying to the Ephesians, and he's praying and he says, that He would grant you, according to the riches of His glory, to be strengthened with power through His Spirit in the inner self, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to all the fullness of God. And this week, in preparing for today, I thought to myself, is it really possible? Could I really understand the width and the length and the depth and the height of God's love? And as I'm studying this week and I'm reading this week, it became clear to me, if I'm going to come to an understanding of the dimensions of God's love, I'm going to go to the cross. And this is what I found this week, and I read that the cross pointed in four ways, basically in every direction, because God's love is wide enough to include every person. God's love is long enough to last through all eternity. God's love is deep enough to reach the worst sinner. And God's love is high enough to take us to heaven. And I praise God for how wide and long and how deep and how high His love is for me. Yeah. But there's nothing that I've done to earn it. There's nothing that I've done to deserve it, because He loved me first. And He demonstrates this love in this, in 1 John 4:19-20, He says, "This is how God showed His love among us. He sent His one and only Son into the world that we might live through Him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." Thank you for His love, right?
Singing over me. coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Today, God, that you would open up every heart, open up every mind. And God, I just thank you for your overwhelming love. I ask this in your precious name, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Church, it's so good to see you. If you've got your Bibles, we're going to be, of course, in the book of Revelation. And boy, I want to thank you for adjusting to the service time changes. And I know the 8:30 service was just about as well as attended as this one. And I asked them, I said, do you like it at this time? And all of those early morning weirdos said, yes. And all of you later sleepers would prefer the 11 o'clock, huh? Can I get an amen? And oh, see? All right. It's so good to see you. You know, we've been in the book of Revelation, and I'm going to tell you this morning, if you're visiting with us, we're so honored that you're here. We are coming together today to celebrate the Lord. Amen. That's why we're here, is to learn more about Him, go deeper in Him. And as we've been studying the book of Revelation, if you're just now joining us, then I would love to tell you what's happened and where we're at today. Because you need to know that as you listen to this sermon. And so in Revelation chapter 1, John is caught up from the island of Patmos. And he's caught up into heaven, and he is shown several things. And before he sees these things, God says, I want you to write down what I'm going to show you, John. And I want you to send it to the seven churches. And he does. And of course, we have it available for us today. So John begins to write, and we come to Revelation chapter 2 and 3, and you know this, that Revelation chapter 2 and 3 is the day and age that we're living in right now. It's the age of the church. And when we went through that, we realized that each of the seven churches represents a different period of our history, and we can see that now. And so when we come to the last church, the number seven, the Church of Laodicea, we understood and we could see that this is today's church. It is the day and age where the church is waning cold and people are walking away from the Lord. They don't want to hear the truth. And what we have being preached in our world today is this propaganda that is leading us to what we're going to see today, a one world church, a one world religion. Hey, listen to me for a moment. 75%, I just read it this week, a George Barna study, 75% of Protestants now believe that Jesus is not the only way to heaven, and yet they call themselves a Christian. Can I just say this, dear friend? You need to pick up your Bible and read the Bible, because it clearly declares that Jesus is, listen to me, not one of the ways, not one of many, not if you choose him. Like, listen, he is the only way. Like, there is no other way unto the Father. And Jesus said it so well in John 14:6. If it's not him, then you're not going, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. As we sang about this morning, praise God, he paved that way, that we can know him and become one of the 99. Amen, Jeff. Praise God for that. I praise him. He is so good. You know, so we leave the church age. And let me tell you, we're in the church age. The day of grace. This is it. And in two chapters, we read the word church 19 times in chapter 2 and chapter 3. After chapter 3, there's no more church. You don't read the word church until chapter 19. And so what happens is this. The church is taken out. The rapture takes place. The Bible doesn't use the term rapture. It uses the two words caught up. We are caught up. We are taken away to meet the Lord in the air. And as 1 Thessalonians 4 says, it's going to happen in the twinkling of an eye, dear friend, that we are going to be removed from here. We're going to meet the Lord in the air. And let me tell you, if you read the Bible, you will know when God's people is removed from a situation, judgment ensues. And in chapter 4, we began studying the Great Tribulation. Last week, we looked at chapter 12. Today, we're going to look at chapter 13. And dear friend, let me just tell you, let me just be very clear. Only God, let me say this up front, only God knows the future. Do you know that? Nobody else knows the future. Hey, you want to see that God knows the future? I'll give you a homework assignment. Go and read Daniel chapter 2. Go and read Daniel chapter 7, I'm going to address it very little today, but what God does prophetically to Daniel, and chapter 2 is amazing. Daniel's life is on the line. He's about to be killed by the king, and he says, God, you got to show me the king's dream, and I've got to interpret it, or the king is going to take my life. And dear friend, God showed him the dream. God gave him the prophecy. And the prophecy was what the Gentile nations would be in the history of the world, leading all the way up to the kingdom of God. And you know what? That prophecy has been 100% correct if you know the history of the world. And let me tell you something. Only God knows the future. Man doesn't know the future. If a man claims to know the future, he's wrong. Let me give you a thought here. In the year of 1870s, in the 1870s, there was a man. He was the bishop of the Church of the United Brethren in Christ. His name was Milton Wright. He was outraged at a college president's suggestion that 50 years, within 50 years, men will fly through the air like birds. Well, the bishop was shocked by these words. He addressed it, and here's what he said. Flying is reserved for angels, and I beg you not to mention that again, because you will be guilty of blasphemy. Those were his exact words. 33 years after the bishop made that statement, his two sons, Wilbur and Orville Wright, launched their powered aircraft at Kitty Hawk. We are reminded man does not know the future. In 1943, Thomas Watson, who was the chairman of IBM, said this, "I think there may be a world market for possibly five computers." In 1977, listen to this, Ken Olson, founder and CEO of Digital Equipment Company, said this, "There is no reason whatsoever that anyone would want a computer in their home." I wish he was right. I'd rather not have one, wouldn't you? In 1876, a Western Union internal memo went out. It said that this telephone has too many shortcomings to be seriously considered as a means of communication. The device is inherently of no value to us whatsoever. And look at where we have arrived today. How many of you have one in your back pocket or in your purse? Huh? You've got one with you, right? Almost every single one of you. Make sure it's silence for the service, okay? Anyways, all right? Let me tell you, man cannot predict the future. Only God knows the future. And let me tell you why. Because God's in control of it. Amen. God has written the script, and we're not going to err from the script. And dear friend, let me tell you, that's one reason why the Bible is so important. Do you know who else does not know the future? Satan doesn't know the future. You see, in chapter 12, the conflict in heaven has ended. As we looked at last week, Satan's defeat and his final overthrow from heaven. He was cast out of heaven in chapter 12 of Revelation to no longer have access to it. None whatsoever. And in Revelation chapter 13, let me tell you, we have a detailed description. You see, let me back up and say this because maybe you missed last week. You see, up until chapter 12 of Revelation, in the midst of the great tribulation, Satan had access to heaven, to the throne of God. And we read that in the Bible. We looked at, for example, last week in the book of Job. And we looked at the words of Jesus, and we looked at some of those texts that says, you know what, Satan is an accuser of the brethren, and he accuses them night and day. But you know what, in Revelation chapter 12, that access is totally cut off. Satan no longer has access. He is completely shut out. Well, you know what, dear friend, he becomes livid. He is enraged, and what he does in chapter 13 is that he brings his very best against the kingdom of God. Now, we know that Satan, please hear what I'm going to say, he is a spirit being, amen? Did you hear that? And you know what? He cannot operate unless he possesses humanity and does his work through a human being. And so I want you to know that. You see, take for instance Judas Iscariot. Judas, in Luke 22 and verse 3, it says, "Then Satan entered Judas, surnamed Iscariot, who was numbered among the 12. Satan entered Judas, and then Judas went and carried out what Satan wanted him to do, to hand Jesus over, to be crucified, to sell him out for 30 pieces of silver, right? Satan knows, listen to this, his time is short. He knows it. And so he comes in rage and fury, dear friend, to do as much damage as possible. Now, let me tell you this. I know chapter 13 is not pretty. As much as it is hard for me to preach, it's probably hard for you to listen to. But I want to tell you, I know God has much purpose in it. Even though you and I as children of God are not going to be here through the great tribulation, we will be removed. But I want to tell you, God wants his people to know what is coming so that we will have, listen to me now, some urgency in our heart. You know what? That we will sing like we've never sang. That we will play like we've never played. That we will witness like we've never witnessed. That the church would become a light in the darkness. Man, chapter 13 is a wake-up call because two rebels, two beasts are going to arise in chapter 13. Let me tell you this. Chapter 13 calls them beasts, but I want you to remember Satan does his work through humanity. They are called beasts. They're not actual beasts. They're human beings. But Satan is going to fill them, and because what they do is so cruel and so inhumane, the Bible calls them beasts. The Lamb who holds the title deed to the earth. Here we are in Revelation 13. He's about to come in Revelation 19. And you know what? He is going to take back his own possession. And Satan knows this. God is going to take back the earth and the control of it. And dear friends, Satan knows this. And chapter 13 unfolds his all-out plan of attack against the divine will and sovereignty of God. So if you've got your Bibles, let me just tell you, standing in the shadows of the book of Revelation and standing in the shadows of the history of the world is the Antichrist ready to come on the scene. Today we're going to look at five things, four of them about this beast, the Antichrist. The second one that is going to arise is the false prophet, and I want you to see it. So the first few here, I want you to see this about the Antichrist. Number one, if you've got your bulletin inside, you'll find an outline. I'd love for you to jot these things down. Number one, the social agitation that delivers the beast. The social agitation. Look at verse 1. Then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having seven heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name. You know, here, sea and water is simply symbolic of, please hear what I'm going to say, multitudes of wicked people that are going to be on the planet, dear friend, of every tongue and every tribe and every nation. We see this represented in Isaiah chapter 57 and also Revelation 17, 15. Let me read to you Revelation 17. It says, then he said to me, the waters which you saw were the harlot. Where the harlot sets are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. And so we know that this is what God is referring to. Let me just back up and say this. The stage is set, and it is being set right now before your very eyes. This social agitation that is going to usher in the Antichrist. You see, there is a troubled sea of disturbed and evil people, and the waves are getting bigger and bigger. Russia, look at what they've recently sought to do in the in Ukraine. Ukraine, a nation that is turning toward God, a nation that is allowing the gospel in their school system, the free speech of the word of God, and they actually are welcoming it. You know why Russia is filled with such venom to wipe it out? I'll tell you why. Because Russia is in support of this Islamic fundamentalism, and Russia is merely a launching pad for the religious jihad that hates Christianity. What about China? Talk about social agitation. Let me tell you this, dear friend. China recently boasted of a 200 million army. And you know what? We just studied Revelation 9, and I think the number is rather interesting because in Revelation chapter 9, it tells us that a 200 million man army is going to align itself along the great river Euphrates. I want to be very clear with you about something. China is no friend to the United States of America, and they are no friend whatsoever to world peace. And this is brewing. It is brewing. And think of what is happening in the, you don't hear of this, of the spiritual vacuum that is taking place in Europe. People are walking away from God, walking away from the church. And listen to me, when you turn from the one true and living God, the Bible says that you will slippery and slide yourself all the way to the bottom to worship creeping, crawling things. And right now in Europe, it is filled with New Ageism and occultism. This group of nations is being unified in Europe into an awesome power. And let me tell you, it is the fulfillment of Bible prophecy that says this very clearly. The old Roman Empire is going to be reunited. And then you think about the worldwide terrorism. Because of Islamic fundamentalism and its religious jihad, we are now facing, and we have seen it unfold, horrendous things such as biological warfare, chemical warfare, suitcase bombs, hijacking, and who knows what else. And let me tell you why. Because in their demonic religion, they teach that the more people you can blow up, the more you will be rewarded in eternity. Unbelievable. What about Israel? I just showed you last week how they are surrounded by the Arab nations, and Israel has a nuclear bomb. And let me tell you something, if pushed to the edge, they will use it. And we have failed this morning to mention, during the Great Tribulation, the famines, the natural disasters, the political upheaval that are a part of the world events that are going to be taking place during the Great Tribulation. Would you look at me for a moment? I want to tell you something. You don't want to be here. You do not want to be left behind. You want to make sure that you know the Lord Jesus Christ. You think we're living in perilous times right now. You haven't seen nothing yet. Historian and author Arnold Toynbee said this: by forcing on mankind more and more lethal weapons and at the same time making the world more and more interdependent economically, technology has brought mankind to such a degree of distress that we are ripe for the deifying of any new Caesar who might succeed in giving the world unity and peace. And I would say this, he's exactly right. Can I ask you a question? Have you ever looked around and thought recently, where is the leadership in our world today? I mean, really, is this all we've got? I mean, out of all of humanity, this is what we have leading. Listen, there is an incredible escape of leadership, and it is different, setting the stage for the one to come known as the Antichrist that will lead like no man's ever known. I want to give you a second truth here about this Antichrist. The satanic attributes that describe the beast. The satanic attributes. Let's learn about his family just a little bit. Letter A, his father. His father. What will the Antichrist be like? First, I want you to notice his father. Revelation chapter 13, verse 1, it says, "Then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising." Now, this is referring to the Antichrist. "Rising up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name." Now, we just defined what that meant for you last week, and so I'm not going to go back and dig into that again. but it reminds us, dear friend, of what we read in Revelation 12, verse 3 and 9. And let me just say this, it's the exact same thing I just read to you here in chapter 13. So we could sum it up this way. Like Father, like Son, the Antichrist is going to be just like his Father. Just like him. You see, as a matter of fact, the Bible teaches that when this Antichrist comes, please hear what I'm going to say, he will possess all of the power of Satan. You see, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9 says, the coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan with all power, signs, and lying wonders. When Jesus was on the earth, Jesus made a very bold statement. In John chapter 14 and verse 9, he said, he who has seen me has seen the Father. Right? Let me tell you, the Antichrist could say the same thing. He who sees me sees my Father. The one who has seen me has seen my Father. And I want to tell you why. Because all of the attributes of Satan is going to be put into this man. He will be a consummate liar, just like his Father, who will perform the works of his father, Satan. So we learn about his father. Letter B, let's learn about his family, the Antichrist. I get this question all the time, is the Antichrist alive and on the face of the planet? What family is he going to come from? We don't have to guess at it. His family, we know his father, let's meet his family. It tells us in verse 2 about a lion, a bear, and a leopard. Interesting, let's see it. Verse 2, now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. Now, that's a mouthful, and I want to seek to break it down just a little bit. Just this morning, I read in Daniel chapter 2, but also in Daniel chapter 7, it is amazing, the prophecy of the book of Daniel. How Daniel could hear from God and write down what's going to happen for the rest of history, in the future. You see, the first world empire ever known was the Babylonian Empire, and Daniel described it as a lion. Now, I'm going to make a point, but I got to give you a little background to it, okay? Daniel described the Babylonian Empire as a what? Very good. Everybody get it? As a what? As a lion. Oh, very good. The lion is the royal king of beasts, right? Ravenous appetite. This tells us a lot about the Antichrist. He will have incredible strength. He is able to terrify every other leader in the world. Let me give you the next empire that Daniel tells us about. It is the Medo-Persian Empire in Daniel chapter 7 and verse 5. And Daniel refers to this world empire as a bear. This world empire is going to be like a bear. Now, a bear has massive strength, powerful claws to crush its victim. I was recently reminded of the strength of a bear. We put this Duraliner feeder on the side of our shed in our backyard. It's made of Duraliner material. You can't even bend the stuff. And I put it on the side of the shed, and we're feeding the deer. It was rather exciting because these females will almost come and eat out of your hand. So I took the feeder and I filled it with 40 pounds of deer corn, and I thought, well, that'll last a long time. 40 pounds of deer corn? So I went down the next day and looked, and as I walked closer to it, I realized it's all gone. How many deer came by? and ate from this feeder in 24 hours. It was empty, only about 10 little pieces of corn left. Whatever ate from this left the squirrels a little bit, you know? Well, then when I got to the feeder, I looked, and on top of the feeder, the bear grabbed that feeder and pressed his claws into it. If you know how thick and how strong this was, it is amazing. His claws just embedded right down into the thickness of that plastic. And I guess he just held it and ate it like a big hamburger. Ate it all. And you know what? I was reminded, I mean, what a good illustration Daniel gives us here of the Medo-Persian Empire and how strong it's going to be. And we know from history it was. It's exactly as Daniel described it. And then Daniel characterizes the Greek Empire as a leopard in Daniel 7 and verse 6. And what he meant by that is it's going to be a quick-moving empire, a quick-in-strength empire to quickly take over the world. And you know what? That's exactly what happened. Alexander the Great, he led the charge. And when he was done taking over the world, he wept. Because there was nothing else left to conquer. This tells us a lot about the coming Antichrist. You see, dear friend, Daniel saw one more kingdom over which the Antichrist would rule, and he spoke about it in Daniel 7 and verse 7, and listen to what he said. He said, "After this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast. Dreadful," listen, he's describing the Antichrist here, "dreadful and terrible, exceedingly strong. It has huge iron teeth. It was devouring, breaking in pieces and trampling the residue with its feet. It was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns." Now, what does horns mean? Power. What does the number 10 mean? Complete, total power in the Bible. And so that's what the Antichrist is going to have. Now, let me sum all this up, and I want you to hear it. You can't miss this. When the Antichrist comes, listen to this. We're talking about his family. He will come from this lineage of empires. And what Revelation is telling us here, he will have the royalty of Babylon. He'll have the strength of Medo-Persia and the sophisticated wisdom of the Grecians. And he will be a combination of Alexander the Great, Napoleon, Caesar, Charlemagne the Great, Hitler, and so much more. And let me tell you this, dear friend, this is the legacy of his family. He'll learn from all of it. He'll be filled with all of it. And he'll lead this world when he comes on the stage. And let me tell you about the Antichrist's fortune. You ready? Let's read about his fortune. Look at verse 2. The dragon, this is Satan, we saw that last week, gave him his power. Oh, but wait a minute, look at this. His throne and great authority. This man is going to receive a throne of authority from Satan to rule this world. I want to ask you a question. Does Satan have it to give? Does Satan rule this world? Is he able to take the power of ruling this world and give it to the Antichrist? Does Satan have it? Let me say this, yes, he does. And let me tell you a little bit about it very quickly. In the Gospels, we read that Satan tempted Jesus to follow him, and he wanted Jesus, as what Satan always wants, he wanted Jesus to bow down and worship him. Do you remember that? And he came to Jesus when Jesus was at his weakest in his humanity, in the flesh. You see, you got to know this about Jesus. Jesus was 100% God, 100% man, 100% of the time. He had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and Satan came to him at a moment of opportunity, he thought. Now I want you to see Matthew chapter 4, verse 8 to 10. "Again, the devil took him up an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory." See all of this? Satan is saying to Jesus, "Look at all of this. See it? And he said to him, Satan said to Jesus, all of these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me. What a knucklehead. Really? But I want you to notice something. Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall not worship. You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. But I want you to notice something. Jesus never denied Satan owning the kingdom of this world, because he does. How did he get it? How did Satan get the keys to the kingdom of this world? Adam gave it to him. When Satan came and tempted him, sin came on the scene, and Adam gave the keys to the kingdom of this world to Satan. And Jesus never refuted it. Jesus didn't accept his offer. Thank God for that. Amen. But let me tell you something. There is coming a man that is so diabolically wicked that he'll give his heart, he'll give his mind, he'll give his soul, he'll give his everything for the devil, and Satan will enter into this man and give him power and authority, and Jesus told us about it. John chapter 5 and verse 43, Jesus said this, and I don't want you to miss what he said. Oh, this is so true. Of course it is. I have come in my Father's name, and you didn't receive me. If another comes, you can read it this way, when another one comes in his own name, him you will receive. Jesus prophesied this, that one of these days the Antichrist is going to come and the world is going to receive him. So I want you to notice number three here, the seductive appeal that disguises the beast. The seductive appeal that disguises the beast. Look at verses 3-4. And I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded. Now you got to catch what's going on here. You can't miss this. So the head of the Antichrist is mortally wounded. You notice the word mortally, right? And his deadly wound, notice the word deadly wound, was healed. And all of the world marveled and followed the beast. Now look at verse 4. So they worshiped the dragon who gave authority to the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like the beast? Who can make war with him? You see, when the Bible uses the term beast, please know this. It's not saying that he looks like a beast in his appearance. He is a beast in his character. You see, the beast is going to be very appealing in his message, in his appearance. He's going to be handsome. He's going to be charming. He's going to be clever. He is going to be intelligent. And the whole world, as Revelation chapter 17, verse 8 says, the whole world will be in amazement and wonder at the beast. They'll ask this question, who is like him? Who is able to make war with him? And one of the ways, let me tell you this, we just read about it, I want you to miss it. One of the ways that the Antichrist is going to gain the attention of the world and the stage of the world is he's going to be mortally wounded. Don't miss this. He's going to get a wound to his head. It's going to kill him. And he is going to be resurrected from the dead, brought back to life. Now, let me tell you this. The devil is nothing more than a counterfeit. And what is he doing here? He sees what happened to Jesus. He sees the death of Jesus. He saw the resurrection of Jesus, because Jesus went to hell, I believe, after his resurrection and said, guess what? You lose again. Huh? You thought I was dead, but let me tell you something. I came back to life because I am the Son of the living God, and I have power over death. Satan sees the grand following that that has achieved. And Satan says, you know what? I know how I can get the world to follow after me. And so what am I going to do? I'm going to receive a head wound. I'm going to fake my death. I don't know if you were at the dinner theater last night, but Philip, who was in the early service, was the lawyer. He was put on the chef hat, the attorney, and he died from eating a pie. Collapsed right here on the stage. We came up and drug him off. I was asked to do that spur of the moment, by the way. By the time I was done, Philip is heavier than what he looks, I don't tell you. Ben, I felt like I had dragged a deer through the woods for about 300 yards from here to there. And then we helped him up. And you know what? You know what happened during intermission? He come walking out through there and everybody saw him and ruined the whole thing. Like, I mean, it was so real. Like, everybody thought he was dead. Then he came walking out. You know what? That's exactly what the Antichrist is going to do. He is going to fake his death. The whole world seemingly is going to buy into it. He's going to resurrect, come back to life. And let me make a point here before we move on. The devil has always wanted to, dear friend, imitate God. For everything that God has, Satan counterfeits it. Let me give you a few examples. There are counterfeit Christians. We call them hypocrites. They're not real. They look real. They act real. They're not real. You know what? There is a counterfeit church. The Bible calls it the synagogue of Satan. You know what else? There is a counterfeit Trinity. What have we read about? The dragon, which is Satan, the beast, which is the Antichrist, and then the false prophet we're going to see today before we're done. The anti-father, the Antichrist, and the anti-Holy Spirit. The devil is a counterfeit. And let me tell you something. People are going to buy into it. They're going to believe his lies. And 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1 tells us about it. It says that there will be seducing spirits. There will be doctrines of demons. Jesus spoke about it in Matthew 24, chapter 24, verse 24, when he said this, "For false Christ and false prophets will rise and show great signs and wonders." Look at this. "If possible, to even deceive the elect." Those that know the truth even. Those that know better. Satan is going to seek to deceive them. That's how strong his deception is going to be. Would you look at me for a moment? Let's just bring that to modern day right here. Don't ever look down your nose at someone and say, "How could they do that?" Don't ever look down and say, "How could he leave his wife? How could he do that on his wife? How could they do that? How could they fall to drugs? How could they? How could they? How could they?" Let me tell you something. Satan's got a trap for you too. He's going to come after you too. He's already messing with you, right? And let me tell you something, young people. Let me tell you something, adults. If you don't stay in the Word of the living God and saturate, listen to me. I don't want you to miss what I'm going to say. Saturate your mind, your head with the truth. You will be next. The Bible says you know the truth, and the truth has set you free. Look at me for a moment. You know what you're going to do? You're going to walk out that door today. You're going to go home. You cut the TV on. You'll cut your music on. You'll cut this on. You'll get around these friends. And let me tell you something, folks, listen to me. Satan will constantly be sending you his subliminal messages. He'll say things like, "You're not so attractive. You're not so pretty. Look how overweight you are. Oh, look at your teeth now. Oh, look at your hair. Oh, look at your stomach. You got the furniture disease, right? Your chest fell into your drawers. Oh, look at you. Look how bad you are. I mean, look at your life." And Satan will, listen to me now, Satan will constantly be picking you apart. When God says, "No, don't listen to him. Listen to me. Read my word, and in it you will see what I think about you. You will see how much I love you. I stretched out on a cross for you." Psalm 139, the Bible says that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Whew. Let me give you another truth about the Antichrist. The sinister ambitions that drive him, that drive this beast. What motivates him to do such a thing? How in the world would you want to take such a stage and ultimately one day fake a death and a resurrection? I mean, who would want to do all this? What motivates him? Well, we don't have to guess at it. The beast wants people to worship Satan. Look at letter A here. He is coming to deify Satan. He wants to make Satan look like God. The devil has always wanted to be worshipped. Look again at verse 4. So they worshiped the dragon, that is the devil, Satan, who gave authority to the beast. Now watch this. And they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like the beast? Who is able to make war with him? Let me tell you, dear friend, just as God the Father receives worship through God the Son, the devil is going to receive worship through the Antichrist. Are you following me? Did you get what I just said? The devil is going to receive worship through the Antichrist. Let me give you the second motivation for the Antichrist. He is coming to defy the Savior. Look at verses 5 to 6. And he was given a mouth, speaking great things. And look at what he speaks, blasphemies. And he was given authority to continue for 42 months. Then he opened up his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name. Do you see that? To blaspheme his name. Look at what else? His tabernacle. And those who dwell in heaven. You know what? He's going to be blaspheming you and me. He's going to be blaspheming the church. He's going to be blaspheming those who were raptured and taken out. He's going to be blaspheming them as well. We as well. The Antichrist is a blasphemer. Do you know why? Because he cannot touch God himself, and so he is reduced to name calling. Blasphemy is going to come out of his mouth as he takes everything that is good and he twists it. Everything that is pure, he's going to twist it. Everything that is holy, he's going to seek to corrupt it. And the ultimate blasphemy is going to be when he walks into the temple, the tabernacle, the house of God that is going to be built. He's going to stand in it 3.5 years into the great tribulation. He's going to look at the world and he's going to say, I am God. You remember the term Antichrist? You know what it means? You see, we don't read the term Antichrist in the book of Revelation, but it is found in the first two epistles of John, 1 John chapter 2 and 1 John 4, and then also found in the 2 John chapter 1. The prefix anti means this, against and instead of. That tells you a lot about him. He is against Christ. And he comes to make himself look like Christ. He wants you to follow him, worship him, serve him instead of Christ. He comes against Christ by being false, acting like Christ, and he's going to lead many people astray. Let me give you letter C here. What motivates this person to be the Antichrist? He is coming to destroy the saints. Look at verse 7. It was granted to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. Did you see that? Those who know Christ that are on the earth during the great tribulation, he wants to make war with them, overcome them, and then look at the rest of verse 7. And authority was given to him over every tribe, tongue, and nation. You know what he wants to do? Listen to me for a moment. Satan wants to stamp out every Christian on the face of the planet. Look at me for a second. You get a sense of it today, don't you? You that go to college, you who are in high school, you who are in middle school, you go, and you know what? They don't want you wearing your religious shirts. They don't want you gathering around the pole. They don't want you praying. Society is trying to snuff you out. It's everywhere. It's all around, right? It's only going to get worse. Christians are the laughing stock of society. It's going to become more and more and more as the end of times is drawing near. And let me tell you something, that's why you and I, as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, need to have a bulldog grip on the truth and stand on it like we've never stood on it before. Can I tell you one reason why I love coming to church? Because Satan doesn't want me here. Do you know why I love to stand and worship? Because Satan hates it. That's just one of the reasons. I do it primarily because I love the Lord, right? But I get a thrill out of the fact that he doesn't like it. Do you know why I love to preach God's word? Because number one, I didn't want to do it. God called me to do it. And number two, God's put the message in my heart. And number three, Satan don't want you to hear it. You wouldn't believe the spiritual attacks and the warfare. You know what? I know I'm doing the right thing. I know I'm telling you the right message. I know this is tough. This is hard to go through the book of Revelation. You wouldn't believe how many times the enemy has spoken in my mind and said, just get away from Revelation. No one wants to hear Revelation. Go on to something that they want to hear. You may not want to hear it, but we need to hear it, and it is the word of God. It's a message that God has put in my heart, and we need to hear it, and we need to know it. And we need to have an urgency in our heart for the days and the age in which we live. Listen, if Satan hates it, you ought to seek to be it. You see, he is coming to destroy the saints. I want to tell you something. I'm not trying to scare you. But I do praise God I'm not going to be here during the Great Tribulation. But what I know is Satan hates those who love God. During the Great Tribulation, true believers are going to face torture, terror. They're going to be lined up, and firing squads are going to level every single one of them. They're going to be put into gas chambers. You're going to laugh when I tell you this, some of you. But they're also going to be placed into concentration camps. And many of them would die by guillotine. I don't know what's going on in America, but I can tell you a little bit about these concentration camps are all over America. You don't hear about it. You don't read about it in the news. But your tax dollars has not so long ago went into these concentration camps on these secret hidden farms that no one knows, and they've remodeled these concentration camps. They've also sent in these tractor trailer loads of these containers that are made of Duraliner material, and they have a bottom and they have a cap, and they will hold 3 to 4 bodies depending on the size of a person. Why is this happening? Why is this going on? I'm not trying to scare you. I can just see it all coming together, can't you? I can just see it all lining up, that the hatred of Christianity is brewing. And let me tell you this, the world is going to want you and I out of here. They're going to hate you. The more we stand for truth, the more we're going to be hated, the more we're going to be called bigoted, narrow-minded, and everything else. And let me tell you something, I don't care if you call me all of those things, just call me along with it, a Bible-believing Christian, and I'll be okay. Amen. Amen. You too, huh? Let me give you letter D. He is coming, the Antichrist, to dominate society. He's coming to dominate society. Verse 7 tells us that there's coming a time when this beast will have global control. How will he do this? How will he do this? Let me tell you two ways. He's going to intimidate. He's going to browbeat. Others will gladly follow him. Those who don't, he will beat them into submission. By persecution or reward, the world is going to follow after him. The world is moving right now even to a one world currency and a global government control. It's interesting, this electric car movement is just one way of controlling you. This digital money, do you not see it? We are quickly going to become a cashless society. Credit card companies spend millions and millions of dollars every single year replacing your lost or stolen credit cards. Credit cards will eventually be no more. You can already see. Now, we live in the small town of Roanoke, right? Some of you in the small town of Moneda, huh? Some of you in the small town of Bedford. And yet you can walk into the Walmart in Bedford and take your phone and go beep and pay for your order. Pay for whatever you're getting. Your credit card, you just touch it. You don't swipe it anymore. Let me tell you something, dear friend. This is all going to quickly change. We're going to become a cashless and credit cardless society. You will pay through the scanning of your eye, through the scanning of your face. You will pay through maybe a thumbprint. You might pay through something called a VeriChip. Have you ever heard of it? A VeriChip is something that is smaller than a grain of rice. They can take it through a needle and inject it into your hand. It's awfully attractive. It's a GPS device that'll track you everywhere you go. You can be on the beach. You feel like, oh, I'm having heart trouble. You can call your doctor. You don't have to go visit him anymore. He can read your vitals through this chip. Let me tell you something. He is coming to dominate society. Letter E, he is coming to delude sinners. Look at verses 8 and 9, 8 to 10. All who dwell on the earth will worship him. Do you see that? Whose names, oh, but not everybody, listen to the rest of it. Whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. The true followers of Christ will not worship him. Everybody else will. In verse 9, if anyone has an ear, let him hear. That's God saying, wake up, church. That's God saying, listen to what I'm getting ready to tell you. Look at verse 10. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with sword must be killed with a sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. What is God doing here? God is writing and he is encouraging for the Christians to be faithful. Be faithful. Be faithful. I want you to remember something. There is coming a time when the tables are going to turn. The beast himself, who has used the sword, will be decimated by it. Now, what sword is God going to use? He's going to use his word. You're going to see it unfold in chapter 19. You just hang in here. You're going to see the power of God's spoken word when he speaks. Oh, dear friend, it's going to be awesome. But let me just tell you this. I want to, before I move on to the last point, I want to tell you this. The closer we get to the end of time, you're going to see more and more horoscopes. You're going to see more and more demonism, more and more occultism, and more witchcraft. Don't read this stuff. Does it have power? Sure it does. Does it have ability to work in your life? Yes, it does. Stay away from it. You go into the bookstore, Books A Million, I think it is, out in Valley View. When you walked through the door last time, my wife and I went in there. We only went in there because somebody gave her a gift card. Well, as soon as we walked through the door, what is there is a display of Ouija boards. Did you hear what I just said? Ouija boards. We walk on through the store, and there's another display of Ouija boards. We walk on around the store, and there's another display. What are you doing? Like, you've got three displays of Ouija boards. What's up with that? Let me tell you this, dear friend. Stay away from it. Listen, more of it is coming as we draw near to the end of this dispensation and God takes us out of this place. More satanic and cultish worship is going to be unfolding in front of your eyes. What happened last year with this rap guy? And I don't know the names, and if I did know them, I wouldn't share them with you. But he took a Nike shoe, created his own, and injected into the Nike Air area blood for demonic cultish worship. Not only are the bookstores buying into it, the news media buying into it, these who get on the stage singing rap songs and stuff that's very ungodly, they're buying into it and they're spreading the message. And you've got actors and actresses and all of this demonic stuff that is teaching your children to worship Satan. And look at me for a moment. All around the country, after school, we now have a club teaching young people to worship Satan. It's coming. It's unfolding. Look at number five with me, and we'll wrap up. The supporting agent who declares the beast. The Antichrist has a supporting agent who's going to make him popular and make him known to the world. And the Bible calls him the false prophet. The false prophet will be energized by Satan and will perform great signs to get people, please hear what I'm going to say, to get people to worship the Antichrist. Revelation chapter 3, verse 11 and 12 says, "Then I saw another beast coming up out of the earth. He had two horns like a lamb, spoke like a dragon. And he exercises all authority of the first beast in his presence and causes the earth and all who dwell in it to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed." Dear friend, how is this false prophet going to carry out his work in getting people to worship the Antichrist? I'm going to give you three ways very quickly, and I'm out of time. Let me just say this. Letter A, deceiving wonders. We already talked about this. He'll get a head wound. He'll resurrect. And it's all staged. And it's all to get people to see miracles. Look at me now, dear friend. Watch out for these people who claim to be miracle healers and miracle workers and all of this stuff, dear friend. Nothing of any eternal value whatsoever takes place apart from the Holy Spirit of the living God. Know that, right? I'm going to tell you this. Do you mind if I tell you something, if I take a little more of your time? We had somebody not so long ago in the church that was standing around with a group of new believing women in Christ and standing there holding hands. I knew something was always weird about this woman. Like, her spirit didn't align with mine, you know what I'm saying? I don't mind telling you that because it didn't. And she's standing around with this woman, and all of a sudden she starts speaking. I know I'm opening up a can of worms here. She starts speaking in tongues. And when it was all over, these women were greatly confused. And let me tell you what she said. She said, "I know some of the demons by name." Well, that's funny because the Bible doesn't give any of them by name. And yet you say you know them by name. Maybe you're filled with one. Huh? What am I saying? Dear friend, you've got to keep your eyes out for this stuff. And let her be enforced worship. The Antichrist, the false prophet, is going to enforce worship. Are you with me? Enforce it. Make people worship. Now I've got to move on, and let me tell you one way that he's going to do it. Letter C, controlled wealth. There's coming a time where the false prophet is going to control the wealth and the commerce of the world. I don't have time to get into this, but Revelation 13, verse 16 to 18 tells us how, and in essence, in order for you to be able to go buy food, you're going to have to take the mark of the beast, which is 666. And dear friend, if you want to make your house payment, you've got to go get the mark 666. Dear friend, if you want to get medicine, you've got to go and take the mark 666. And dear friend, listen, the only way to fill your car up with gas is going to be to take the mark 666. We have already seen governments trying to force their agendas upon humanity, even upon children. Go get the jab. We've already seen the segregation. We've already seen how you'll be treated if you don't. We're already seeing it. Whether you agree with that or not, we already see how government control and mandates are taking place. I have a question. I live in God-blessed America. Where is our freedoms at today? How can you force upon me something that I do not want? Is this not America anymore? I want to conclude by saying this. The stage is being set. You see it. I see it. I hope you see it. The Word of God is telling us these things are coming. I want to encourage you to do one thing today. I want to encourage you to decide, who are you going to live for? Are you going to live for the Lord Jesus Christ? Are you going to love Him with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind and all your strength? Will you do what He asks you to do? Will you be faithful? Will you be in the house of God? Will you get involved in the house of God? Because you know what? It is the church that is to leave its mark on the world, not the world on the church, right? Dear friend, it's high time. I don't know what else to say to you as a pastor and a shepherd. I mean, if there's ever a time to live as a Christian, if there's ever a time to show up and celebrate the Lord Jesus Christ, if it is ever a time, this is the time. Amen? This is the time to live it loud. This is the time to go to your grandchildren, go to your neighbors. This is the time to be sharing the gospel, spreading the glorious news of Jesus Christ. I want to ask you something. Will you say, God, here am I, use me however you want? However you want, here I am. I see the urgency. God, here I am. Send me. I will go. Let us pray together. Praise team is going to come. As they come, I want to ask you to just stand to your feet with me as we close. Would you stand with me? We're going to make this brief, but dear friend, let's do business with God before we leave. Dear church, the invitation is simply this. It keeps coming to my mind in the book of Isaiah, where Isaiah made several excuses. The angel came and touched a coal to his mouth. And Isaiah said, Lord, I will go. Send me. I will go. Send me. Why Revelation 13? It's really a message to the Christian on evangelism. Go and prepare the people that you love. Church, will you go? I don't know what God's doing in your heart and in your life. Could you come to the altar today and say, God, I don't know what you have planned for me. I don't know what you want for me. I don't know what your will is. But Lord, wherever you send me, I will go. Somebody in here has that burning in their heart today. As they sing, would you come? Would you come? God spoke to your heart. You come today. Thank you. Let's go to our Father in prayer this morning. God, we are so thankful for the book of Revelation, Lord, as you lay out the history of the world, the history of humanity. What is this world coming to? It's coming to you. God, we are so thankful for it. What a blessing to know. Lord, you really are the great rescue. God, as you're going to call your people from this place, God, our hearts are heavy this morning. If you were to come today, our hearts, break our hearts, oh God, for those that would be left behind. Oh God, put urgency in the heart of your people to go and be light, to go and live out their faith, to go and be real, a real Christian in the environment in which you've placed them. Oh God, use your church, use your people to be a lighthouse to the lost, and use this church to be a greenhouse to the saved. Oh God, move, we pray. Move, we ask, oh God. Oh God, do it, Lord. Let that fire fall once again, Father. Oh God, do it, Lord. Brother Everett, would you close us in a word of prayer, please? Amen. Amen. God bless you, church. Thank you for worshiping with us.